there's power in patience, because sometimes in patience you have to humble yourself and step back and do something you don't really want to do to get to where you do want to be.
Welcome to It's Not Just You, Girl, where we are real, uncut, raw, and yet holy about the things we face in life as women and how we can overcome them. I'm your host, Aya, and let's get into this, joyful people.
There's power in patience. I sat here and just realized that I am finally 3 days in to eating right for my body, choosing sleep, even though I kind of got sick or my body shut down for about a day. But still trying to prioritize sleep and rest. Doing the things that I didn't necessarily want to do, but I was so sluggish because I was eating so badly. And the funny thing is that, I can't remember who said it. I think it was my coach that said it. But there is power in patience. There's power in patience. Like, patience is a weapon. Because sometimes when you can relax and rest assured that this thing is going to work out, and you don't know how it's going to work out, and you don't really care how it's going to work out, you just know it's going to work out. As long as you do your part, that's all that matters. And that was the power I understood. That each day I made a choice to eat something good for me because I love myself. That's the only thing. Is I'm like, I love me enough that I'm going to eat what is loving, what shows that I love me. Eating a handful of goldfish, boxes of graham crackers, Ritz, popcorn, and things that I shouldn't be eating, all because I'm emotional, I'm frustrated with my weight, but I can't grasp a hold of my weight because I can't stop eating things that I shouldn't be eating, simply because I'm frustrated that I didn't lose a couple of pounds or whatever, when all I needed to do was be patient with myself and eat appropriately. And eat lovingly. You know, and that's the thing, because I don't know about any of you who struggle with food, but literally I'm not eating meals. So really, I'm not very hungry, or I could have just ate a meal and ate a meal that was healthy and it was more satiating. So I wouldn't be going back and constantly eating rubbish. But no, I decided to eat a bag of kettle corn or some plantain chips. Of course, sweet plantain chips. We don't do them other chips. If you like them, I'm not a Satan. They got to be sweet, extra sweet, okay? That's just me. That's how I like my plantain now. But, y'all, me sitting here and realizing that was like, dude, do you know how many times we struggle and waste time and energy all because we are not patient with ourselves? And we could have been how many days in to a new habit built, or how many days into creating something we always wanted to do, or how many days into learning something we always wanted to learn, how many days into already creating the lifestyle that we wanted for ourselves, simply because we decided to take each day at its time. Teach each day at a time. Literally, the Bible says, don't worry about tomorrow. Basically, because tomorrow has its own worries. Just don't even focus there. Focus on today. And, you know, for somebody like me, I don't know. And I don't think I'm the only person. That's why I made this podcast. But sometimes I'm just like, I could literally think too far in the future and fixate on the past, but basically brush aside the present. And I feel like that's such a lethal trait, if that makes sense, because right now, you need to learn how to live in the now. You need to learn how to do what you need to do now for the future. But the problem is that I anticipate the future, and then I start getting frustrated with myself because I'm like, well, I want this to happen in the future, but in order for it to happen in the future, I need to change something now. And I need to change something today. And I need to make an effort right now. But then I talk myself out of it. It's like I talk myself out of my future by bringing up my past. And not the good in my past, the negative in my past. And the thing about being patient with yourself is, I know I want to do this thing. I know this is my 5-year plan. I know this is my 1-week plan. I know that if I think, you know, this is just me explaining, because all of our thought processes are different. You know, like, you might fit into one of these categories. But, you know, like, I know that my plan is for the end of this week. I know that maybe the next 3 days. So I'm going to make a plan for what I'm going to do this next 3 days. Or I'm just going to say, each day I'm going to show up and these are my guidelines. I'm going to eat what shows that I love myself. I'm going to eat what fuels my body, what builds my body, which keeps my body sustainable. If I'm getting sluggish after eating it, if I can't do anything after eating it, if I no longer have feel to work out, or I need to take a nap, these are signs that this is something toxic to me. Basically, if you eat food and feel depressed, this is a problem. You can't do nothing no more. You can only sit there and watch a show. You're lethargic. You are tired. That is not an indication of something healthy. And even if it was healthy, maybe you ate too much of it if it got you to that point. That's not what you want. You basically want to fuel your body. F-U-E-L, fuel your body. So you want to do something that gives you things. And we could take this out of context of food and say, read that book that you know will fuel your body. You know, it could be the Bible. It could be a devotional. It could be an inspirational book. It could be about a new career path you want to get into. It could be Forbes. Maybe you want to be an entrepreneur, so you want to study all of the successful entrepreneurs or the top 50 companies. Whatever it may be, but it's something that is fueling you for where you want to go. You got to put gas in your car, and then you got to start making those slow, you got to start driving up the hill. But you need proper fuel to do that. So if you're on a weight loss journey or all these other things, but all of it comes from the power of you being patient with yourself. That each day I need to show up for me. Each day I need to set aside time and be in the presence of God. Each day I need to set aside time and read something that inspires me for my goal. I need to set aside time and tap into people that will uplift me or hold me accountable. Each day, I need to make good choices. You know, I need to not cuss somebody out and go pray for God to change my heart or theirs before something bad happened. Because it be like that sometimes. You know, or I need to not eat this. Or if I'm craving this, how can I make it healthier? Okay? You know, how can I make it healthier that I still get that same kind of feel or I still get that same kind of thing, but I'm doing it in a loving way? How do I turn that burrito into a salad? You know, like how do I get what I need to go where I need to go and be patient enough with myself to not throw in my own face and listen to the enemy telling me all the times I tried to set out for these things and I failed. All the times that I did these things and it didn't work out. The only time I'm revisiting the past should be, okay, what did I learn back then? Well, I made too many changes at once and it overwhelmed me. And then I felt like because I was doing so much and I became so consumed, I should have had huge results. Or maybe I was successful to a point, but the problem was I started rewarding myself with unhealthy foods, unloving foods. And in the end, it threw me off track for the next couple of days. Or I started to compensate by fasting. And this is not me trying to throw anybody under the bus, because let me tell y'all, I've been on this journey for how many years? And if you ask me to write a book, I can write a book right now. And if somebody follows my steps, they will be successful. But the thing is that they were patient enough with themselves to hear my tips and to start step by step and constantly just keep making changes. The thing about that I think we forget is that when you are patient with yourself, your body is smarter than you think it is. Our minds are smarter than we think they are. A lot of things happen to come naturally, especially when you know that sometimes these things are outside of my flesh. I cannot fully conquer this on my own. So I'm going to God to drop this here and surrender it that, like, Lord, I know I can't do this in my own strength. But I want to do this. So each day, I'm going to show up and do my part. And I need you to do the rest. I remember when I went through a very, very tough season. And I had a very, very toxic job at that same time. And I would wake up in the morning and say, God, I need you to carry me today. And I started to get dressed. I started to read his word. I sat in his presence. I went to Starbucks, got my little cold brew. And, you know, went on my day. But somehow waking up and knowing I'm not in the mood, I really want to call out today, but I have no valid reason except for I just don't want to be here. And I don't want to deal with nonsense today. And, you know, it was a very, very toxic place. I mean, like, so bad that I was literally praying before I walked into the building I would wake up and pray, and then I would get to work, park in front of the building, and start calling the name of my boss. Like, oh God, hear the word of the Lord. You will not stress me out today. If you are not in a good mood, you will not come to my office. You will not talk to me. That bad. I mean, God was faithful, and he did, you know, but like, so you can only imagine the stress of that. Plus, I'm going through my own. But the point was, I surrendered it, and I still paced myself and did my part. I was patient with myself. I made sure I woke up early and had enough time to kind of get the out, you know, because there's nothing worse than you already feeling like that. And then now you wake up late on top of it, or you're going to work late. You know, by that time, you just want to call out because you just feel like it's whatever, you know. But even if so, if you still ask God to carry you, you're running late, you will find that somehow, some way, that day will go smoothly. Because every time I asked God to carry me, trust and believe he carried me, because I was like, I can't do this on my own. But I'm going to be patient. I'm going to trust that God is going to fill in where I can't, and things will get better. You know, I'm going to be all right. Okay. And just making those steps, taking that time for prayer, taking that time to get my coffee so I feel happy, taking that time to get these little things, you know, not saying that the coffee will make you feel happy or stuff like that. But, you know, like, y'all, there was a time where I just had to make coffee, or, you know, Starbucks was a little too expensive. So the only thing I would get was some tea, and I still got I got the tall, which is not tall at all. It's very small because that's what my pockets could afford. You know, so it was almost like a luxury to like, ooh, look at me, you know, one of these business people getting coffee at 7 o'clock in the morning to get to work early. Not even on time, early, you know. Spilling myself. Who is this Aya? What, girl? You grown. You know, as you guys can't tell, I'm a clown. I play a lot. But yes, it felt so good. It felt so good. So those little things, and then somehow something good will happen. My boss will come in on a good mood, or better yet, he won't show up that day. So everybody else in the office was cool, and we just had a smooth day. And something will happen. You know, somebody will say something. Something funny will happen. Maybe a problem that has been, you know, stuck got solved. Something will come. And it would have been a thing that I missed if I had just stayed in my bed and canceled today, because I didn't surrender the day and ask God to carry me through and then still do what I'm supposed to, because we know faith without works is dead. So you still have to work out your salvation. You still have to get up and do your portion. You know, like, I have been filling out a whole bunch of applications, and it has been heck trying to find a job. And I am getting so frustrated. And I was like, no, you know what? I'm going to figure this thing out. So I asked God. I was like, God, I need you to help me. Like, somebody to write my resume. Tell me what I'm doing wrong. What am I saying wrong? What's going on? But I didn't just throw my hands up and say, to hell with it. I'm not doing all of these things. You know, like, I was patient with myself, and I was like, look, okay, this is a whole nother field. This is a whole nother career. You know, maybe there's something on my resume they're not seeing. I'm doing a career change. Yes, I can do the job. I know I can do the job. I know I have the skills to do the job. But what is it that is not being represented in my resume for them to call me to even get an interview? And, you know, the good part about God, because it wasn't that day that I prayed for that. You know, sometimes you pray for things and God gives you an answer. But I was just like, okay, you know, like I need to find something. Funny enough, scrolling on TikTok, I had 3 videos where they were talking about, you know, using the right resume template, getting your resume down to 1 page, and using something that will help you basically like copy and paste the job descriptions, the ones that you know you can do from previous jobs, and putting it into your resume in that way so that when they put it through a machine, which has artificial intelligence, AI, it will pull you out in order to get an interview. Because I know an interview will. There's been many times I've gotten interviews and they were like, ooh, you know, just because you don't have agency experience or you've not, you know, ran a bigger thing, but I really want to hire you. If I had a lower position, I would definitely put you in. If I had something else, I would put you in. But, you know, so I know I interview well because I've had too many people tell me like it's just not, you know, like they need to see this. They need to see that you have managed at least 500 accounts. They need to see that you have done a huge organization, and then we can hire you for our big organization. But because you haven't, but you have all of the skills, and I believe so because what I'm hearing, you know what you're doing. But I can't take this to upper management and say so because they're going to be like, so you do know we're a Fortune 500, right? I mean, her resume is cute, but like, yeah, no, you know, so it's always unfortunate, but it was always a blessing because let me tell you, from where I came from, I wouldn't have applied for positions like that anyways. For them, so for me to get an interview and they still want to hire me if they could, and even put me in an assistant role to prove myself if they had one, so that they can move me up or whatever it is. That alone was reasons to praise the Lord. Because let me tell you, I've done a lot in my lifetime, but a lot of times I short credit myself. So it's beautiful to see that somebody is like, ooh, let me tell you. You know, because me, I was already fetching when I applied for it. And I was like, Lord, I don't even know if they're going to call me. So the fact that they called me, then called me again to tell me that they can't hire me, but they really want to hire me, and they look for a position to put me in, that is a blessing. And it happening more than once, that's the Holy Spirit. That's definitely God's hand on it. And I don't take that for granted. But it, you know, but basically what I'm saying is that, you know, being patient with yourself and not taking it as, oh my goodness, this and that, because it's impatience that'll make you feel like, you know what, I don't even want to do this anymore. Maybe that degree or that little certification that I got is nothing, this and that. Instead of you to say, okay, let me get some more skills. Let me take a course. Let me look at some things. Because it was a couple of days, and then that thing came up from Twitter and was like, you know, this is how you use your resume and you are guaranteed to get an interview. Why? Because now the technology that they scan your resume through says that you have what they are looking for. So they're going to pull you out. Like you have a higher thing of what they're looking for. So now you can go ahead and do it. And then I didn't even know opening a Word document, Word actually has a resume builder in it. So when you use a resume template, it types into LinkedIn, and LinkedIn has all of the job descriptions. So you can literally copy and paste job descriptions from other good resumes for that field you are trying to enter into. So it's just, you know, like these are just some little things. But let me tell you, you got to be patient enough to now do the work, use your resume, and then get back in the field and start applying where you were rejected and where has just opened now. And see what your odds are now that you have the skill set in your resume, now that you have the appropriate things. But it takes patience to cool. Because, you know, like, if I wasn't patient, I probably would have said, like, you know what, forget this, this and that. I'm just going to do a customer service job. I don't know why. I just don't know. Maybe I'm just not cut out for all these things. So now I discredited myself. Now I'm dropping, excuse me, all of the degrees and the certifications that I paid for to get to this point. All of the head knowledge that I have, you know, done for myself to know how to go about this. And then, you know, like, basically I just dropped everything that I have invested in, all because something was not working out. And then if I would have saw that resume builder or something like that, I already would have had a hard heart. So I'd be like, I don't even want to see this. I don't want to see nothing else about a job. I don't want to see nothing else about all this nonsense. I don't even this and that. I already know I can get a customer service job anyway, this and that, blah, blah, blah. I'm overqualified for that. Or, you know, like, and just, you know, because this is how we reason. This is how we reason. When you become impatient with yourself, you become irrational. You do things that are detrimental to the progress you are actually trying to make or the previous progress that you have made. And maybe you are at the verge of your breakthrough and this is just something you need to do. Because sometimes I feel like when you are impatient, you don't even see things that are blessings as blessings. Because literally what you want is God to come and tell you, you know, and have somebody call you out of the blue and say, hey, we got a job for you. And this and that, irregardless of your resume not pulling or things like that. Whereas God is giving you something that, like, look, this is the process for you to get into all these other places. And you may not fully have what they need. Like, you don't have the years of experience for this. You don't have the this and that. You know, you're probably not supposed to be in a mid-level. But what you're going to do is you're going to make your resume sound so amazing because I'm giving you these tools to use. To now go back and put yourself back on the market. And now I'm going to have those places that rejected you accept you and probably put you at a higher bracket or a higher role. Why? Because I know that once you speak to them, you will interview well. I know that once they see what you can do based off of you putting it in a way that you'll stand out to them, they will want to hire you on the spot. And that's the thing about patience. There's power in patience because sometimes in patience, you have to humble yourself and step back and do something you don't really want to do to get to where you do want to be. And you have to see the blessing in all of these things. I'm going to end with another, you know, just very quick something. There was a time that I was learning to surrender to God. So I said, you know, I'm just going to leave everything in his hands. I'm not going to touch it. I'm not going to do nothing. And I'm just going to praise him and be thankful. I'm going to thank him every day. I'm going to constantly, you know, be thankful for things. I'm going to look for the silver lining in things. I'm going to keep thanking him for the things he said he was going to do that I've not yet seen. I'm going to thank him for the things that he has already done in my life. And I'm just going to thank him for things as they happen. I'm just going to be grateful for even the smallest of things and praise him. There was a day, this my boss that, you know, I told y'all he was a lot. And I said, I needed childcare for my daughter because my parents, I think they went out of state. So my mom couldn't watch my daughter. Because my mom, she don't work. But they were out of state and it happened to fall on a day that I had to go to work. I think it was a Friday. So that was it. And I was like, oh Lord, okay, how are we going to do this? So I told them at work, I was like, is it possible I can bring my daughter Or can I work from home so I can get this stuff done because I don't really have anybody to watch her? So they were like, well, you know, I don't even know, but it happened to touch my boss somehow. And he was just like, you know, my mom, we had how many kids? She would take us to the skating rink. She'll wake up early in the morning, fix breakfast and do things. I know, you know, moms, it's hard to be a mom. It's hard to be a woman. So definitely bring her in, you know, like as long as she can stay in your office, you can find activities for her to do. That's okay. You can bring her in. So I said, okay. So I brought her in. I mean, no. Look at me. No. So I was excited. I was very excited. And I was like, Lord, you know, I went back to my office and I was like, Lord, thank you so much for allowing my, you know, my boss to have favor on me to be able to bring my daughter to work, because most bosses wouldn't allow that to happen. And shortly after I did that, I think I was talking with, you know, my friends. And I jokingly said it. I was like, well, if you know anybody that can watch, you know, watch my baby for me for the next couple of days, because I think it was 2 days. I thought it was Friday. Y'all, I don't really remember. It was a couple of days ago. But the point of the story was, I thought that God had already blessed me by my boss allowing me to bring my daughter to work when I needed childcare. And God one-upped me on already being grateful and feeling like that was the solution to my problem by me mentioning something jokingly, which I think it was the Holy Spirit, because the problem was already solved, for my friend to say, I could watch her. And I'm like, what? She's like, no, I could watch her. Look at God. Look at God. You know, like, because I knew bringing her to work, it would have been challenging. I have meetings, you know, I had a lot of stuff that I had to do. So it would have been tough. How are we going to figure out nap time in an office? You know, how are we going to do this? You know, she too, you know, like she was 2 at the time. So like, how are we going to do all of this? But still, I was ready to figure it out. I was already like, okay, well, we got a little sleeping bag. I'm going to bring her little blocks. I'm going to, you know, set her up, put my phone in some headphones. She's going to sit in the corner. We're going to have some crayons, some markers. And we're going to set this up like school and make it work the best we can. I might have to leave early these days because that's just, you know, but at least I'll be able to do what I need to do. Only for my friend to be able to do it. And I was like, look at God. Look at God. I thought I had a solution. And I was praising him for that solution. And maybe that was the test. Because me praising him for that solution, he gave me a better solution right after I thought my problem was already solved. That's what happens when you surrender to God and you are patient and grateful for whatever. Because you know it's all going to work out. And it can end up working out better than you thought. So, I hope this blesses somebody. But there is power in your patience. Be patient with yourself. Be patient with yourself. You will get there. Just keep doing what you're supposed to do. Don't miss God's nudges. Don't feel bad if you need to start over. Just take it one day at a time. If you choose each day, as soon as you wake up in the morning, that I'm going to show up for myself. And God, help me hold myself accountable. Trust and believe he's going to do that. And you are going to get to your goal much faster than you thought. Because you only worried about today. You only asked him for today. And you know what you got to do today. And it is in a line for the big goal. But you're not looking that far. And the only reason why you're looking back is for what he has done. And to thank him that if you did this for me before, you'll do this for me again. So get me through today. and do whatever he asks you to do. All right, y'all. Stay wonderful, stay positive, stay beautiful, stay blessed, and know you are loved.